Mr. Bergeron's on. Don't forget the popcorn, Frank.
Coming, dear.
My name is Arthur Bergeron. I'm an attorney. I work at Myrick O'Connell. Myrick O'Connell has about 55 lawyers. I'm the elder law guy. There are other people that do all the other things. And what I try to do with presentations, sometimes I really try to go in detail and actually bring in guests to be talking about some specific issues. And I try to do that most of the time because you can get really bored listening to lawyers really quickly. But every once in a while, I need to be kind of dealing with things, just kind of updates on where things are. And this is kind of an important topic. So we're going to be talking a little bit about some changes that have occurred over the last year, some good, some bad, regarding MassHealth eligibility. I talk about that issue a lot because people think about it a lot. Because as I always talk to folks, basically what elder lawyers do is they deal with issues that people have when they're about ready to retire and kind of from retirement until they die, right? And one of the nice things about getting older, well, it's good and bad news, but it's like you realize that you're going to die, that there's actually going to be an end. You know, your children don't believe they're going to die. They know you're going to die, right? But we all kind of know, but the goal of the exercise, therefore, is not to not die, but to try to live as well as you can until you die and make sure, among other things, that you don't run out of money. And in that regard, most illnesses that you get between now and the time you die aren't going to cause you to run out of money because they're going to be covered by Medicare, right? That was the point of Medicare. One of the interesting things about Medicare that I found, I was doing some research for it, I did a blog post on this. And prior to the passage of Medicare passed in 1965. In 1960, over 30% of all people in this country over age 60 were defined as poor, right? Today, that number is under 7%. That is all about Medicare. It was people, of course, that back then would get older, they couldn't get health insurance, they'd get sick, they were getting older, and they'd get wiped out, a lot of people. Now, that only occurs if you have Alzheimer's or a related disease that causes progressive dementia. If you have cancer and you need operations and you need chemo and you need this, Medicare covers it, right? If you have Alzheimer's, and you need someone to help you take a shower or get dressed, or they're worried because you're helping to make sure that you don't kind of drift out of the house by mistake, right? Well, Medicare doesn't have anything to do with that. They're just not paying any of it. And so much of what people deal with when they're worried about this stuff is needing to structure things so they can qualify for MassHealth, which is the Massachusetts name for the Medicaid program. And because Medicaid is health, which passed the same year as Medicare, Medicare is health insurance for the old, Medicaid is health insurance for the poor. And so you need to qualify to be poor, quote unquote, in order to qualify for Medicaid. And a lot of people try to do that by doing some planning ahead of time. And that's what we're going to talk a little bit about. And the main thing that so often people think they need to do is, in order to save any assets, is to create an irrevocable trust and transfer their assets to the irrevocable trust and wait 5 years. And you've all heard that. So there are some changes regarding that I'm going to talk about. But first, I want to kind of dispel one myth. I want to talk about my friends Frank and Mary. If you've been here with me before, you know them. Frank and Mary are... Well, they bought a house a while ago, which is still, it's a small house, but it's here in Nantucket, so it's worth $700,000. They have an IRA that's worth $150,000, an annuity, or he does. They have an annuity worth $100,000 and some cash. So they're worth a little bit over $1 million, mainly because they're living here on Nantucket. He doesn't have a lot of income. He has Social Security and a small pension. She has a Social Security check, so their total income is a little under $3,000 a year, but still, you know, they're in Nantucket, so the residential exemption, you're not paying too much in taxes, you know. They're going to not live big, but they're going to be okay as long as they don't get wiped out by something like an extended stay in a nursing home. So suppose Mary feels bad and needs to be in a nursing home for a prolonged period. How many of you here think that in their situation, they're going to need to spend down a lot of money on nursing home care before Mary can qualify for MassHealth? Could you just raise your hands? How many think that's true? Actually, no, that is wrong. Remember those assets. Those are the assets that the Frank and Mary have. Now, to qualify for MassHealth, if you're married and both still alive, and once again, this is not about single people, this is if you're married and both still alive, to qualify, if Mary needs to qualify for MassHealth, she needs to have assets of less than $2,000. Frank, on the other hand, if he's living at home, can own a house as long as it has an equity of less than $800,000. So that's not a huge house, but it's a pretty big house, $800,000, which would qualify here. He has to have cash or cash equivalent assets that can be no more than about $117,000, my recollection serves, $117,240. It's somewhere between $117,000 and $118,000. But the spouse at home in that case, in addition to that cash, in addition to that house, can have infinite income. So in this situation, if Mary went to the nursing home, what they would do is they would immediately transfer all the assets to Frank. Now, by the way, that's why one of the most important documents that every person has to have, you don't have to have a will, you don't have to have trust, you have to have a power of attorney and a healthcare proxy. So that if you're disabled for some reason, somebody can act legally for you. So it's very important in this case, if Mary is in the nursing home and not able to sign things, that somebody has the ability to sign things for her, right? So you transfer the house to Frank, therefore making the house safe. You transfer all the money to Frank. So now Frank would have about $300,000, right? He'd have the IRA and also the annuity, and he'd also have the cash, right? And then, Frank, there's my magic number. Frank would buy an annuity, which is big enough that it would shrink his remaining assets below that magic number, $117,560, right? Now, that annuity has to be a very special kind. It has to be for a term. It has to call for equal payments to him over that term. And the term has to be shorter than his actuarial life expectancy. But you know, if Frank is 80 years old, he still has an actuarial life expectancy of about 7 or 8 years. People are always amazed by that. I thought life expectancy was like 70 or 72 or something. Well, if you're born today and you're zero, then your life expectancy today is in the 70s, male or female. If you today are 100 years old, you have a life expectancy of 2 years, actually, just by virtue of the fact that you're still standing. You have another life expectancy of 2 years. So as long as Frank uses that money, however big that pot of money is, can be $1 million. But if he goes and buys an annuity that has equal monthly payments, even though they're really big, that will pay out during his actuarial life expectancy, the next day, Mary can qualify for MassHealth. Now, there are certain cases, and so in general, if you are married, what you want to do is that. And all you have to do to make sure that you're safe, that your spouse is safe, if you die, because the problem with Frank and Mary is if they have a standard estate plan that says if one of them dies, the other one inherits everything. Well, if Frank dies and Mary inherits everything, now she's got a problem, right? If she needs nursing home care, she has to spend all her money down to $2,000. She'll then qualify for MassHealth, but then MassHealth will lien the house. They'll put a lien on that house to make sure they'll get reimbursed following her death. The way that you avoid that, it's very straightforward. You just change your wills to say that following your death, Frank wants to make sure that following his death, all of his assets don't go directly to Mary, but go in trust for Mary's benefit. Naming one of the kids, naming somebody as the trustee. If he does that, then the day after he dies, all those assets drop into this trust for Mary's benefit. They're all safe. Everything is safe. And Mary can qualify for nursing home care if she needs to the next day. So once again, the key to this is you need to make sure the wills are right as far as Frank is concerned. You've got to make sure that there's a power of attorney available so that if Frank's health deteriorates, and there are still assets that the two of them own, and if Mary's health is bad, we can still shift the assets from Mary to Frank before he dies. And if Frank has medical conditions anyway, then even before Mary has ever gone to a nursing home, you'd want to make sure that the assets were already in Frank's name, so that if he literally just drops dead, instantly everything would be safe for Mary's benefit. So that's kind of what the general plan should be. There are some exceptions to that, even if you're Frank and Mary. There are general ones, and then there's the Nantucket exception. In general, if you have a vacation home, for example, if you are here only because your real residence is in Florida and theoretically you're vacationing here, then that vacation home, everything here still applies as long as you're in a nursing home in Massachusetts and not in Florida, except, remember, you have to convert everything but the primary residence to cash and then go buy an annuity, which means you have to turn the vacation home into cash, which means you have to sell Nantucket, if Nantucket's the vacation home, and turn it into cash. Now, you can do that, except do you really want to sell Nantucket, right? Nobody wants to sell it from Nantucket. And your kids would, they'd go around, they'd kill you. They'd go shoot Frank, you know? Oh, my God, you sold the Nantucket house. So that's an issue. And other large assets. You know, there are other large assets that you may have to convert into cash. For those things, you may instead want to, ahead of time, transfer things into an irrevocable trust. Keep a life estate in the property. We'll talk about irrevocable trusts in a second. So if you're in Nantucket and you have that house, that like one that a client that I have here that bought their house in the early 90s for about $300,000, and it's really a lovely house, but $2.1 million, that's the assessed value right now. It's staggering. So if you have a house that's worth a lot of money, right, and you're Frank and Mary, then you really have got, you've got, there are two possibilities. There are only two possibilities. One, if it's worth a little more than $800,000, and when I say a little, if it's worth $300,000 or $400,000 more than $800,000, then you could do the same thing, but you would shift the house to Frank and have Frank take out a reverse mortgage, even though he doesn't need the money. He wouldn't use any of the money. He'd take out a reverse mortgage, which would cost him $12,000. That's about what a reverse mortgage will cost, no matter how big it is, about $12,000. Take whatever that money is, all of that extra money out, and use that to put it into that big annuity, right? But in the meantime, by taking out the reverse mortgage, he is driving his equity in the property down. So if he has a property that's worth $1.2 million, and he takes out a $400,000 reverse mortgage on it, takes the cash and goes and uses it to buy an annuity, his remaining equity is only $800,000, and all of a sudden Mary can qualify, because remember, he is the spouse at home, can have a house that's worth, that has an equity of up to $800,000, right? The only other possibility would literally be he'd have to sell the house. He could sell the house, turn everything into cash, go buy a gigantic annuity. And by the way, when I talk about those, we've literally had people buy annuities for $1 million, $1.5 million, protect all the money, right? And still qualify the spouse for nursing home care. But if that's not an option for you, right, or if it is the vacation home, then you really need to do, and by the way, that goes through what Mary's assets would have been if Frank had died. If you're Mary right now and you've got those assets, and you've got $1,025,000 in assets, but the really big one is the house, then probably what you want to think about doing is transferring that house to an irrevocable trust. And we're going to talk about that a little bit. So